invited Dr. Awdhesh Singh, basically for this purpose, that all of us need some sort of perspective shift from excise and service tax to GST. And I welcome you, Dr. Singh. It is very nice to have you once again in our midst. Looking forward to your lecture. And I hand over the mic to him to carry on from here. Thank you.
Good afternoon to all of you, and I'm very thankful to Madam who has given me this opportunity to share my thoughts. And I'm also very delighted that Sanjay, who is a very old friend of mine, and we know each other before even when we joined the department, so that is how the friendship goes. And he shall also be sharing his thoughts with us. All said and done, the purpose of the law should be, number one, that we should be able to collect the taxes which are due. And number two, in my opinion, the second most important thing is that the taxpayer should be having a better level of facilitation and comfort in the GST regime than it was in the earlier regime. Now, when we are saying that we are moving to a better regime, then the better regime should be from the perspective of the taxpayer as well as from the perspective of the department. And if the taxpayer is facing more difficulties in compliance, or some of the benefits which are already available to the taxpayer has been taken away in the GST regime, then we definitely cannot be said to be a forward-looking GST. So let me share my perspective, and I will welcome your comments and views, and also criticism if you feel any. And so let's move forward. So what was the purpose of the GST? We have been hearing GST since very long. In fact, I was in Nasir Faridabad for almost 2 years, and we started providing training for GST way back in 2010. And we saw that it was implemented only now, but we had been preparing for GST for a very long period. The goal of GST was that in the entire country there should be one law and one tax, so that you know the markets are integrated. People have the opportunity to sell their goods and provide their services across India without the barrier of the state, without the barrier of check post. And then our purpose was also to reduce litigation, because we have found that there are a large number of issues where, you know, service and goods are integrated with each other. In fact, as a matter of fact, almost every case you will find that goods and services are integrated with each other. Whenever you buy anything from the market, there is already a component of warranty and service along with that. If there is no warranty for that, the value of the goods substantially reduces. As a matter of fact, it is possible to sell any goods as a service. Like for example, instead of selling a car, you can give the car for 10 years of lease and collect the entire amount in advance, and that can be a service rather than a goods. Similarly, in the works contract, there has been tremendous difficulty in deciding what is a service component, what is a goods component. And almost every issue, a composite contract, we had so many litigations. So what we basically were thinking, that if the goods and services are combined, then those sort of litigations will go. And when all the VAT and other taxes of the central and state will combine, then perhaps the litigation between the state and central will also go. You may be very much aware of the litigations about the SIM card, software, where the state were taxing, central were also taxing. We were also saying sometimes it will be good, sometimes it will be a service. So all those litigations we thought will go away once we have the GST. But what we have found is that GST, the way we have implemented, we have actually not getting the benefits as we expected. So I have given 10 points. I will quickly go through that, and then we will discuss about it. What are the issues in GST regime? The first important point which I noticed in the GST regime is that we have taken away the small scale exemption. Even though we are saying that the taxpayers have the exemption for 10 lakhs or 20 lakh rupees, but actually there is no exemption notification. In the central excise, we had exemption up to 1.5 crore, and the service tax, we had the exemption of 10 lakhs. But in the new regime, there is no exemption as far as the providing service and goods are concerned. The exemption is only from registration. And there are 11 plus categories of services where there is registration compulsory, irrespective of the amount. So as a result of which, if you are registered, then you have to pay taxes. This is again a provision. You may be aware that in service tax, we had hardly 4-5 lakhs of taxpayer, or maybe 6 lakhs taxpayer. But we had more than 10 lakhs of registered taxpayers. And we were not expecting them to pay any taxes because their threshold, their turnover was supposed to be less than 10 lakhs. So even though suppose you had a registration certificate, but unless you voluntarily decide not to take the exemption notification, you are not required to pay taxes. But in the new regime, there is no exemption notification as far as the goods and services are concerned. As a result of which, for example, if I am an interstate supplier of goods, then if I am supplying even one piece of goods from, let us say, from Delhi to Noida, if I am supplying one piece of the goods, then I have to take registration. And the moment I take registration, even the local things become taxable. So that is one thing we have to take care of, that we have to give an SSI exemption to all the goods and the services which is not provided in the new law. Then there are 11 plus of categories of suppliers who need compulsory registration irrespective of the turnover, and all registered units are required to pay taxes and file return irrespective of the turnover. Now only supplier of services has been exempted for interstate supply by the recent notification in the October and November, and other people, like if you are supplier of the goods from one state to another, you are still required to pay taxes. Now, what I suggest in this regard is that we should provide an unconditional exemption to all taxpayers for 10 to 20 lakh rupees. But at the same time, like a PAN, for example, if you just take a PAN, it doesn't mean that you have to file an income tax return. And it doesn't mean that you have to pay a tax from the zero limit. Let us make it mandatory for all the businesses to take GST, that they will take the GST identification number. But they will be required to pay taxes only when their turnover crosses the exemption limit. In that way, we will be able to keep track of all the transactions which are taking place. At the same time, we will give them the liberty not to actually pay the taxes unless they want to forego the registration for their own benefit. And we will say that you will not be required to pay any GST, and you won't be eligible even for the any income tax, the input tax credit. And only when that you have the turnover more than that, you have to avail the exemption. In both the cases, as you know, in central excise and service tax, it was an option of the taxpayer not to avail the exemption. If they don't want to avail the exemption, they will not. Otherwise, they will avail the exemption. The next important thing is, which is creating a lot of trouble in the market, and in fact, today also in the NDTV there was a program, and it was regarding a Gujarat traders, and they were saying that, you know, after the GST has come, their business has really collapsed. Now, why it has collapsed? It is like this. See, we have made mandatory for certain categories of employees or certain categories of service providers to do a compulsory registration. Like casual taxable person, then you have interstate suppliers, then agents, then reverse charge mechanism, then electronic commerce operator, ISD, and TCS, TTS, data SSE. Now, these 11 plus categories, they have to compulsory register even if their turnover is smallest, even if they do first transaction. But okay, I can understand that if I am doing a part interstate transaction, intrastate transaction, then at least I should get the benefit of duty-free clearance for the intrastate. But the law does not provide like that. The moment I take registration, I have to pay duty even for the intrastate transaction. So this is perhaps not the intention, and that we have to avoid. So the list is required to be pruned substantially because it is actually hurting the concept of One India, One Tax. From if Delhi, I cannot do business in Ghaziabad, I cannot do business in Noida and Faridabad, then what is the concept of All India market? So I will suggest that, all registered units have to pay taxes and file returns, and the tax compliance, as you know, three returns has to be filed. Of course, one return we say, but two are the details which you have to file, and that GST 1, GST 2, that is compulsory. So ultimately, the tax compliance level is very, very high. And so it distorts the concept of one nation, one tax. So what I suggest is that GSTN may be given like PAN, as I have already said, but they should file the return only when their turnover is more than the specified limit. Then the third very, very important distortion which has taken place is in the terms of a reverse charge mechanism. I remember the reverse charge mechanism was introduced somewhere in 2011. And the purpose of the reverse charge mechanism was that when we found that a large number of taxpayers, issuing the invoices, for example, we found largely in the case of BPO's companies, that for example, they are hiring taxis and they are taking security services. And these chaps were actually, charging service tax on them. And those people were very coolly, they were taking the refund of also those service tax. But when we inquired, we found that these chaps who are service providers are not paying any taxes. And so in that year it was brought, and we thought that ultimately the responsibility should be shifted to the service recipient so that we collect the taxes. But we have to understand is that in the new GST regime, we are anyway going to verify the credit only when we are going to allow it. And therefore, this need is going to be largely eliminated. The second thing is a very interesting case. For example, if you are an author, for example, I'm just telling like my own example. Like suppose you are an author, and authors is a very meager royalty. So maybe you are getting a 5,000 or 10,000 rupees of royalty. Now your value of the service is only 5,000 or 10,000 rupees. But that it is in the reverse charge mechanism. If you are giving the copyright service, it is in the reverse charge mechanism of service. And the publisher has to pay service tax on your behalf. As a result of which, what happens, you adjust that amount while making the payment. So imagine that 80% suppose you have to pay. So you are getting a 5,000 rupees of royalty and 80% will be deducted because this fellow has to pay. And he is supplying goods, he is supplying books which is exempted from taxes, and therefore he cannot take any credit also on that. So it is a next burden, it's a burden on him. So this reverse charge mechanism has this problem that it does not give any benefit or it does not give any exemption to the provider of the service. Irrespective of that limit, you are charging the taxes from the recipient of the service. The reverse charge mechanism also has a very, very important drawback. The drawback is the supplies made by under the reverse charge mechanism are treated to be exempted supplies. So let us say that I am providing a supply, I am giving a supply which is covered under the reverse charge mechanism, and I am actually taking some input credit also. Now I cannot use that input credit. That input credit lies based because the entire duty has to be paid by the recipient. And then that person may or may not be able to take the credit depending upon whether his final product is liable to GST or not. So as far as I am concerned, in both the cases I am the loser, because suppose my liability is 10 lakh rupees and I am having a credit of 5 lakh rupees in my account, I cannot use that credit because that credit, that supply is treated to be an exempted supply and that credit goes based on my part. So this is an important thing that the entire flow of the credit breaks the moment the service is coming under the reverse charge mechanism. And the second thing is that in the reverse charge mechanism, there is no exemption as far as the provider of the service is concerned. So this has to be actually brought, and this is a net burden on the exempted, on the person who is receiving the service. Because as I told you that a publisher, for example, he cannot pass on the work burden because his services are exempted and therefore he has to use the it is costing. Then it hurt the service provider and also the service recipient. Now what I suggest here is that we can prune the list of the RCM and actually limit it only to the limited category, like the, for example, GGA, it has to be there because I don't think that it is possible, and many categories we can keep, but a large number of categories we can exclude. And then we can also permit a voluntary registration if the RCM service provider wants. If I am providing a service and I want to give, I want to register, I should be allowed to register, and the RCM liability can be divided 50-50% in such cases so that at least I am able to take the benefit of the input tax credit which I have paid on my recipient. Then, and this exemption can also be granted of 10 to 20 lakhs to all the service providers, including those are in the RCM. Now I give an example. You see, RCM concept, if you see, it is something like a TDS in the income tax, where the employer is supposed to deduct the income tax on behalf of the employee. I think something like that. But as you know that the employee gives an undertaking less than 2.5 lakhs, then there is no TDS required to be deducted. And if he is able to provide the document as to the saving documents and his tax liability is not there, then the employer is not required to deduct any income tax. We have to have a similar sort of mechanism that if the person is giving an undertaking, whatever way the government wants, that his turnover is less than 10 lakhs or 20 lakhs, in that situation, there should not be any liability on that person. But nevertheless, lest the GSTN be made mandatory, let him quote all transactions, whatever transactions he is making, and let him make all the GSTN reference on that. Just like in the PAN, if you deposit 50,000 rupees and above in the bank, then you have to necessarily give your PAN. In the same way, we can say that if your transaction value exceeds, say, 5,000, 50,000, whatever amount government decides, then you have to necessarily give your GSTN number. But nevertheless, tax liability will not be there, but the government will be able to, through their system, they will be able to find out as to what is the amount of, what is the value of service this person has provided, because this we will be capturing in our system database. So this is my suggestion in respect of the reverse charge mechanism. Now this reverse charge mechanism for unregistered supplier, I think this has come to the largest criticism, as you may be aware that a case has also been filed, a writ has been filed in the Delhi High Court also in this regard, and the government has for the time being withdrawn this tax up to March. But nevertheless, I think that is, as far as I am concerned, I think it was an excellent provision which was brought, because a lot of businessmen are actually making fake bills by just showing some supplies, some receipt of the supplies, so they are evading income tax. They are also evading the GST on that. So it was a very good move, but somehow there was so much of resistance that the government has decided not to totally withdraw. The greatest drawback of this was that it has made even the interstate supply. Suppose I am an interstate supplier and my turnover is less than 20 lakhs. In that case, government says, okay, fine, you don't have to take the registration. If the moment it is interstate, then anyway I have to take registration. If it is intrastate, I am given an exemption. But the moment I supply my goods to any of the B2B supply, any businessman purchases, then he has to bear my tax liability. So as a result, what has happened that the benefit, tax benefit which the government gives to the small taxpayer, so that they can become more competitive in the market, that benefit has been totally taken over. I remember when we used to hire the taxis in our commissionerate in most of the places, I think the same practice may be doing here also, then we will generally take it from a small taxpayer because they will be within the tax bracket less than 10 lakhs, so they will be supplying, and we will be able to pay them better amount because they will not be liable to pay the service tax. Now as a result, imagine that for them also I have to pay the service tax at the same rate as if I hire it from any big taxpayer, then that benefit has taken away from that person. So as a result of which, he has now been treated at par with the multinational or the big taxpayer, and so the entire purpose of giving the small scale exemption has been totally defeated the moment the person is giving a supply to the registered person. And the registered person will then prefer that I should take a supply from the another registered person rather than taking a supply from an unregistered person. So this is something which I think the government has to consider. But what I suggest here is that instead of taking away these provisions of 9.4, let us follow this practice that the exemption will be available, but the GSTN number has to be compulsorily captured. Because GSTN number, once it is captured, we know that if the person is actually supplying less than 20 lakhs or actually supplying more than that. So we will be able to account for all the supplies, but at the same time, the liability will not be there on the